From the top down, we must be inclusive.
You have to be loud. You have to be different. The audiences are demanding it.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to this evening's Take the Lead Transparency Talk. I'm Jeffrey Hirsch, President and CEO of Starz. We have a wonderful conversation ahead this evening. I'm really looking forward to it. Thank you to the MPA for hosting this wonderful evening and being great partners. I'm super excited to be back in this room. We were here 3 or 4 years ago to premiere a Power episode, and we had asked everybody not to do any spoilers, and within an hour, there was 1,000 spoilers out. So I don't know if that's a good omen, but in terms of the talk tonight, we hope that everybody leaks this out and then it spreads around the world, and really the message that we have tonight gets out in a big way. So thank you for doing that. I am so honored tonight to have the opportunity to introduce the second gentleman of the United States, Douglas Emhoff, here to kick things off for us. Please, everybody, put your hands together for Mr. Emhoff. Thank you.
Oh, hey. Good evening, everyone. Well, it's good to see so many of you out before the event. I see a lot of friends out there, especially my good friend Jeff Hirsch, who I knew in my life as an entertainment lawyer. And Starz is so lucky to have you, Jeff, and our industry, or my former industry, your industry. It's so great to have people like you who care about content. You also care about the community. And I look forward to continuing our discussion that we had earlier today about how we can partner with the industry, our government, business to have more women in the entertainment community. Yeah. And more women in leadership in general. Yeah. And that is something that is so important all the time, but as we celebrate Women's History Month, it's even more important. But again, as my wife, the Vice President, would say, I don't know, you know I love saying that. But she would say if she was here, we gotta do this every day. This is a 365-day-a-year endeavor to support women and lift them up and just celebrate their accomplishments. Celebrate the accomplishments of women across the nation to pay tribute to the trailblazers, but also pay tribute to the women who are out there each and every day holding it down. And you know who they are. That's what this month is all about, and that's what we need to do. Like I said, I have been in this industry for a long time, but now I've been second gentleman for about a little over two years. And I travel the country and I travel the world. I realize the rest of the country and world isn't like where I come from on the west side of Los Angeles. And there's a lot of stuff out there that's not fair. There's a lot of women out there who had things that were not great before COVID, all made worse after COVID. And it's just, frankly, it's not right. And so as someone who is just honored to be in this position by virtue of being married to the Vice President, but now that I'm here, I'm gonna use this microphone to continue to lean in and advocate for things that we need to talk about, like equity, gender equity, pay equity, childcare, family leave, all the things that we know we need all throughout, but we also need them in the entertainment industry. Now, I was in that business for a long time. Too often that the folks working behind the camera and the folks running the companies do not look like America. And it doesn't, frankly, look like what's in front of the camera as well. And we need to change that. We need to change course on that. And this is something I didn't just come to because I'm second gentleman. I was a lawyer for a long time, and I love being in the entertainment industry. I miss it. And all the time I was in the industry, I did everything I could to give back. And how did I do that? Well, I served on boards, like the Motion Picture Television Fund and the Association of Independent Commercial Producers. And when I did that work, it was to help the industry. And most of the work that we did was for folks behind the camera, to take care of them, make sure we leveled the playing field. And so now, I think it's so important to use this microphone to advocate for diversity in the entertainment industry and diversity in all industry. And with Starz and the MPA, I am so glad to be here because they are leading by example, by having an event like this, working to advance strong representation, both in front of the camera, which we're doing an okay job on, but more importantly, behind the camera and in the front office. Now, through initiatives like Starz Take the Lead and Transparency Talks, like the one that you're gonna hear today, they're working to shatter stereotypes, which hold people back, and build a more inclusive business and really a more inclusive society. And making sure that the leaders of the next generation are reflective of who we are as a country, but also making sure that the stories, the people writing those stories, are real stories that are bold, unapologetic, that reflect this culture that we need of inclusion and equity. And those are not bad words. Those words are important. You should not be pushing back against inclusion, fairness, and equity. Those are ideals that this country is based on. And so we have so-called leaders who make those bad words. They are not. We need to push forward on that. My boss, President Biden. Well, Kamala's my boss, but President Biden promised that this administration would look like our country, to lead by example, and we have succeeded. So apart from the first woman and woman of color as vice president in all these years, the Biden-Harris administration is comprised of the most diverse group of people, including women at the highest levels of government in United States history. Yeah, you can clap for that. Record number of female cabinet secretaries, senior White House staff, and I work with them each and every day. We have the first ever gender policy council, which does amazing work. And through an all of government approach, we are leading efforts to advance gender equity, from protecting reproductive health care. And this is something that my wife has been traveling all around the country fighting for. Economic security for women and families, so everyone has the same opportunities to succeed. And also something that I've worked on, as well as many in the administration, responding to gender-based violence, which is a terrible problem. And also, we travel around the world representing the United States of America. And we see when the United States leads, the world follows. So we need to be strong on women's rights here so we can be strong on women's rights and human rights all around the country. The court system. Our judicial appointees are the most diverse of any administration, both in terms of personal and professional backgrounds. And of course, president nominated, and we got confirmed, now Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson, my friend. And when she got confirmed, I was there. I had to see it myself in the Senate. And she shattered a historic barrier by securing her place as the first Black woman on the highest court in the nation. And I was there when she got sworn in. So while there's a lot to celebrate, the work's not over. This is a fight we all of us, must be in. Everyone must fight for gender equity, because we all must acknowledge and work to address long-standing gender discrimination and the systemic barriers that have held back women and girls. There is power in coalition. There is power in allyship. Like I say all the time, this is not just a women's issue. This is an issue for all of us. Because when we lift up women, we lift up the economy. We lift up our society. It's not an either or. So when one woman succeeds, it doesn't mean someone else is failing. It means we're all being lifted up for the better. So now is the time to all join forces like Starz and MPA to advance gender equity, increase diversity, not only in the fields of entertainment, but in all fields. We know that there's still more progress to be made, and this change, it doesn't happen overnight. It takes generations sometimes. It can be slow, it can take time, and we live in this society of instant gratification. Well, guess what? Some things worth fighting for, you gotta fight for them. So I know I'm gonna do my part. I'm gonna do everything I can each and every day on behalf of my wife, the president, the first lady, this administration, and this country, and this industry, to be your partner through this journey so we can have some fairness, some equality, and some equity, which will be a better future for all of us. So you can. And I'm going to introduce an amazing woman who, someone I know, she is a brilliant, brilliant person, brilliant lawyer. She's one of the world's leading authorities on copyright, Karen Temple. She's the head lawyer at the MPA. So if you were an entertainment lawyer like me, she is someone you wanted to know and be in touch with. She heads the content production efforts, legal affairs all around the world. She's had extensive experience in the private sector, volunteer positions. She does it all. Please join me in welcoming Senior Executive Vice President and Global General Counsel for the Motion Picture Association, Karen Temple. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Emhoff, for that kind introduction. I'm honored to welcome you back to the Motion Picture Association. Good evening, everyone. I want to welcome you all to the MPA for this important program, celebrating the power of women leaders in entertainment and government. Welcome to those who have joined us at our global headquarters here in Washington, D.C., and those who are watching online. First, thanks to our friends at Starz for organizing tonight's Transparency Talks program, both the panel discussions on gender equity that will start in a few minutes, as well as the reception that will follow. We're thrilled to be joined tonight by several Starz executives, including Chief Executive Officer Jeffrey Hirsch, President for Original Programming Catherine Bubsby, and Executive Vice President of Corporate and Brand Communications Jennifer Minazaki Washington. Also in a minute, I'll introduce Allison Hoffman from Starz to say a few words about the panel. I'm also delighted that we have Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett of the U.S. Virgin Islands. Thank you, Congresswoman, for joining us tonight and participating in our discussion. As we meet tonight, in the first week of Women's History Month, and one day before International Women's Day, I can't help but reflect on the power of this gathering and its importance for government and for the entertainment industry. This topic is particularly resonating with me, given my personal experience having spent 15 years in various government positions throughout my legal career. My last role as head of the United States Copyright Office gave me a unique insight, a seat at the table, if you will, on the obstacles that women have faced and still face within government. In fact, though I was the 13th U.S. Register of Copyrights, only 5 women have served in that role over the history of that office. The first female head of the U.S. Copyright Office, Barbara Ringer, did not break that glass ceiling until 1973, and then only after she filed a gender discrimination lawsuit to obtain that position. The Copyright Office's sister agency, the USPTO, the Patent and Trademark Office, which had its first head appointed way back in 1802, had its first woman appointed to head that office in 2015 by then President Barack Obama. So over the course of the history of the USPTO, there have been 59 confirmed heads of the office, but only 2 confirmed women heads of that office. The second is Kathy Vidal, appointed by President Biden last year. Yes. So today, I will say today, the heads of the USPTO and the head of the Copyright Office are both women, with Shira Perlmutter heading the Copyright Office. So we have two of the IP agencies that for the U.S. government that are headed by women today. So a round of applause for that, everyone. Thank you. So while we can certainly celebrate how much progress there has been, we also must recognize that a lot of work remains to be done. I know that both Register Perlmutter and Director Vidal have announced initiatives to explore ways to support inclusivity in the patent, trademark, and copyright systems. Of course, the entertainment industry, too, has a long way to go before we reflect the true diversity of this country and the world, both in front of and behind the camera. From the top executives and A-list actors to writers and producers to below-the-line crew, our industry and the stories we tell often do not represent the full spectrum of American society. But the MPA, where I should note almost 60% of senior executive staff is female, round of applause for that, is driven by our core mission to ensure that all creators, men, women, and people of every creed and color, gender definition, and socioeconomic status have every opportunity to entertain and inform, to challenge and inspire. As the MPA enters our 11th year of formal DE&I programming, we continue to work both as an organization and in concert with our member studios to promote inclusivity by supporting greater opportunities for a wider diversity of creators. We deeply value, for example, the working relationship we've built with so many impactful partners. To name a few, the Gina Davis Institute of Gender and Media, the Black Girl Film School, Black Girl Films Camp, the Imagine This International Women's Film Festival, or Reframe, as well as the great teams at Women in Animation and Women in Film. Through these relationships, we are advancing the careers of women in this global industry and empowering them to tell their authentic stories. Through this work, we are empowering our industry partners to ensure that films and TV shows, and yes, even culture itself, reflects the voices of all of us. With that, it's now my pleasure to introduce Allison Hoffman, President of Domestic Networks for Starz, to share more details about the program you're about to hear tonight. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Karen. I'm going to lower this. Thank you so much, and thank you for your partnership and MPA's partnership in putting this together. And thank you to the second gentleman for your support today. We were so thrilled to have you. For those of you who aren't familiar, Take the Lead is our company's commitment to narratives by, for, and about women and underrepresented audiences. It's what our entire business is built around. It is not a side initiative. It is what Starz stands for through and through. As part of this commitment, we have been working with members of Congress to introduce legislation to make September Lead Month, or Leading Entertainment and Arts Through Diversity Month. Simply stated, the goal is to underscore the need for increased representation in media and entertainment. I'm very excited to share that Congresswoman Yvette D. Clark of New York officially reintroduced the Lead Resolution March 1st. Very exciting. In recognition of Women's History Month and our work with Congress on LEAD, we were inspired to center today's discussion on how women in entertainment and government can join forces to improve society. Big topic. We have amazing panelists that are going to get into this. To get the conversation started, I'll turn it over to Tara Palmeri. She is senior political correspondent and partner at Puck News. Thank you, Tara, and thank you to the wonderful group of trailblazing women on today's panel. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the kind welcome, Allison. I'm so pleased to be here moderating this very important conversation with four women who are not only trailblazers, as Allison stated, but women who have forged paths and worked tirelessly to empower and ensure that women and individuals from traditionally underrepresented groups are afforded more opportunities. It's a pleasure to welcome you to this month's Starz Take the Lead Transparency Talk. That's hashtag take the lead if you want to tweet. Starz has hosted these talks since April of 2021, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to their first live event in Washington, D.C. Today's panel and topic will focus on how women in entertainment and government can come together to advocate for increased representation that will continue to shatter stereotypes, attract diverse audiences, and bring a more create a more inclusive society. One piece of housekeeping. For our virtual audience that is watching right now at home, please enter your questions into the chat. For our live audience, we'll make time for a few questions from you as well. And now I'd like to introduce our truly amazing panel. Nicole Collier is a vice president at Procter & Gamble, leading its government relations efforts. She has spent 20 years of policy and public affairs experience and has advised Fortune 500 companies as well as nonprofits. She serves on the Starz Take the Lead Advisory Council. Thanks so much. Madalene Mielke is the president and CEO of the Asian Pacific American Institute for Congressional Studies, or APAICS, where she brings nearly 25 years of experience working on political campaigns, and she specializes in political nonprofit fundraising and political training. Patina Miller is a Tony and Grammy Award-winning actor and singer with a successful career on Broadway and television and film. She plays Rock in the Starz hit show Power Book 3, Raising Kanan. Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett is a member of the House of Representatives. Before being elected to represent the U.S. Virgin Islands, she was assistant district attorney for the Bronx and worked in the Department of Justice. Thank you all. And I'd like to start by asking all of you how you all tackle diversity and inclusion in your companies, organizations, and industry, and how do you do it to affect political change and industry change? I'm actually going to go grab a seat over here. Do you want to start, Nicole?
Sure, thank you. So my name is Nicole Collier. I work for Procter & Gamble. I'm based here in Washington, D.C. Obviously, that's a very big question. There's a lot of ways that we find it possible to try to impact change. Obviously, we're one of the world's largest advertisers, and we take our buying power and our influence and our dollars very seriously, and we know that when we make a decision to move on something, that it can make a real impact in people's everyday lives. And we know also that the largest consumer group that's growing, that can actually equal market growth for our brands, are multicultural consumers. We know that. I think a lot of people know that, but what they're doing to act on that, I think, distinguishes us. So we've done a lot of things. I think I'll talk a little bit later about Widen the Screen, which is one of our big initiatives. It's kind of an umbrella initiative that has lots of advertising and short film representation underneath. I think we showed something from the Queen Collective, which is a partnership we did with Queen Latifah and Flavor Unit Entertainment and Tribeca Films. And we've really done our best to not only focus on representation and advertising and the ads that you see, your favorite brands, hopefully. You use Tide and Oral-B and Scope and Crest and all of our great brands daily, but that you see yourselves in that work. And so we're really proud of that. And I think that we've been really willing to talk about it with other brands and other companies in hopes that it will actually change the ecosystem.
I'm Madalene Mielke. I'm president and CEO of APEX, the Asian Pacific American Institute for Congressional Studies. I want to take a moment to thank MPA and Starz for having me here today. This question is large, you know, and it takes a lot of different players to be able to engage in this question. My role at APEX really is to bring more Asian American, Native Hawaiian, and Pacific Islander diversity and representation into public service, really. And we do that through the work with the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus, so the members of the U.S. House of Reps and Senate. And that work really is in correlation and coordination also with my colleagues over at the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation and the Congressional Hispanic Caucus Institute. And as the Tri-Caucus, we really understand that communities of color working together as allies to amplify and to support each other in this really big question to an answer that we are all striving towards is something that we feel is important in terms of the lens and perspective of our respective constituencies and communities. We all come with a narrative, and we're all storytellers. We all have stories to bring to our work and our authentic selves that bring a narrative that we want to see reflective in our democracy. We want to see it reflected in our media, in the arts and culture. And really, you know, the founder, one of the founders of APACS is a former member of Congress who's the first Asian American to be appointed into the presidential cabinet. His belief was that we are not homogenous. We are all threads that are woven into the fabric of the United States. And that means bringing your authentic self to bring your narrative to really create the story of America. And that, to me, is how we can address some of the diversity, inclusion, and equity.
Thank you.
I would say for me, I have been given the great opportunity to have the platform that I have as a creative and as a storyteller to be visible and to be in this visibility where I can sort of inspire young women, people of color who look like me, to dream. And you know, for me, growing up, I didn't really have, there wasn't a lot of visibility in the entertainment, you know, world where you could see yourself reflected. Also, you know, the dreaming was limited. And so for me now, my biggest thing that I love that I get to be an inspiration for younger people, women, people of color who've always wanted to do what I do. And I've tried to take on projects that really tackle all those things. You know, I look for three-dimensional characters. I always look to take the stereotype and play against that. And for me, that is really important. It's always inspiring the youth and talking to as many people as I can about having a dream, sticking to it, working hard, and doing what you can. And so, you know, being at Starz, having this creative family where I can really do the things that I've always wanted to do, take on a character like Raquel from Raising Kanan, and really just, you know, paint her in the way that I want to paint her. And, you know, for me, she's so universal and you know, she's a lot of different things. And there are a lot of things about her that whether you look like me or not, you can draw from. And so for me, it's just about being inspiration and continuing to take on characters that push the narrative. And, you know, that's it.
Hello? Yeah. First, I'm fangirling because I'm a power fan here. And Patina, I just want to thank you for your creativity and thank you, Starz, for allowing these kinds of characters to be available for all of us to see, and not just people of color, but people who are not of color to see the complexity that is representative of the African American and people of color in this country and throughout the world. And that's a really great question that you have, because I mean, that's what I do every day, right? Is when I walk into the spaces that I walk into, it's about representing people of color. It's about representing in my full self the complexity of who we are and the layers that we are as Black people in this country, as a woman in this country. And there are several ways, I think, as a member of Congress that you try to do that. And I'll give you a couple of examples. Last year, myself and two really great members, Richie Torres of the South Bronx in New York, and a member from Maryland, Strickland from Washington State, we got together and we decided to create a caucus, the Caucus on Black Innovation, because we believe that there are so many Black innovators that are out there in this country that are not getting the support through investment dollars, VCs, as well as the federal government. And so we use our bully pulpit to be conveners, to try and bring people together, to try and push the discussion about issues that are important to Black people. Then, of course, there's just legislatively that we have a responsibility to then support legislation which protects and advances, whether it's protecting women's reproductive rights or advancing gender equality and equal pay for women and others in the workplace and in society, making sure, as you know, myself and my caucus, Hakeem Jeffries is always saying, that we want to make sure that everybody gets home safe. The police officer, the Black boy, the families, the old woman who's trying to get home from the grocery store, that everyone gets safe. So trying to advance those issues as well. And then, of course, just speaking out, using the floor time that we have to call people on nonsense, to call and check people, right? You gotta keep them in check half the time about some of the nonsense that they say. And that's our role. I think that's my role as a member of Congress as well.
Yes, absolutely. This is for Madalene. You're a recognized civil rights leader. You're dedicated to advancing diversity and bringing political change. But in your 25 years of political consulting, what kind of challenges have you encountered as you deal with government agencies and politicians, trying to get them to understand why inclusivity matters?
That's really aging me right there.
Sorry.
very serious question. I think, one of the things that is most important is intentional commitment. And I think that has been evident through this current administration. I was just saying, as I was listening to the second gentleman, you're taking all my lines, because you saw that this administration was dedicated in its commitment to putting a Black woman on the Supreme Court, saying that they wanted to also have a diverse cabinet. And in the beginning of this administration, I must say, my colleagues in the Asian American-centered organizations and I were very vocal in the fact that although we have Vice President Harris in her role, and now two Asian American women who sit in the cabinet, we did not have an Asian American who led a cabinet agency. And so along with intentional commitment is also accountability. And also the fact that we will be here to remind you that we are always striving for a more perfect union. And that includes making sure that no one feels that they are excluded. Because we have seen public policy directed to the Asian American community, whether it's the Chinese American Exclusion Act, Japanese Americans incarcerated in internment camps, after 9/11, seeing our brothers and sisters who were sick, who were not Muslim, and even then, the idea of profiling. And so those types of public policies are a part of evolution of also understanding circumstances and having a lens from people who have personal narrative experience. So Secretary Mineta, who served in both Democratic and Republican administrations, was in the Bush cabinet when 9/11 happened. And because of his presence, President Bush commented, "I do not want to have anyone go through what Norm went through when he was interned as a small child." And that was really a reflection of also his presence in the cabinet for people to understand that public policy affects people. And that when you have people who are marginalized, who are also on the edges, you do not have a robust, dynamic conversation of how public policy affects everyone. And so DEI is really about making sure that you don't exclude people who you don't think of because they're not in the room. And then people who might have a platform can give that platform to others because they have a voice. And so we don't need to, we just need to make the table bigger. It just also means that, the mic that, I might have the privilege of holding means I give it away to someone else to share their own story. I don't need to tell their story for them. And so I think challenges are always going to arrive as we evolve as a country. The Asian American community itself is the fastest growing demographic in the United States.
And that in itself means that, you know, representation and being able to have stories of people who are coming from my community feel that they have the ability to express themselves and still have that representation.
Thank you. Nicole, P&G launched Widen the Screen, a broad initiative partnership platform to increase the inclusion of Black creators in advertising, film, television, and the media industry abroad. It's a spectrum for us to see images, voices, and stories that have not always traditionally been heard or seen. So what was the impetus for this initiative, and what's the response been?
So, I mean, I mentioned before where the United States in particular is seeing growth in populations, and we know that that is through racial minorities, multicultural people, people who are identifying as all different ethnicities and races. And we knew we needed to reach those communities. And we also wanted to see, I mean, Widen the Screen is, as I mentioned, an umbrella. There's a lot of different initiatives that fall under it. We started really first with Black people and Black populations and really not seeing Black people portrayed as their full selves on screen. And obviously our platform is advertising and marketing. That's how we demonstrate the superiority of our products, is by communicating through ads. And we felt like we had a powerful platform there. And so we really focused on, you know, I think maybe 5-6 years ago, you saw our first short film called The Talk, which was about several different images of parents talking to their Black children about what to do if they're pulled over by the police, how to survive that situation, how to behave. And it was a real awakening for other parts of America who never had to have those conversations. I remember seeing it for the first time as a young mother of a son, of a Black son, and being in tears, just seeing that related to me back on in broadcast on television. And we went on to do The Look, which was about people being followed in retail, followed around stores, followed around different places they went, and kind of the, what, you know, stereotypes and kind of what that person's full self and that person's full day was actually about. And we've gone on to do other things related to just seeing beyond stereotypes, seeing the full person. The reaction has been incredible. I mean, certainly we have detractors, but beyond just making, I think our intention and our objective is to understand our consumer better, to know what they want to see from us, and that was fully achieved through Widen the Screen. Not only that on the consumer side, but we were able to build a platform, because within Widen the Screen, we are really bringing Black creators in particular to advertising. So we want to see people behind the camera and in front of the camera, and we've been able to do that, launch careers for 300 Black creators. We've also doubled our spend with Black media, and we'll double it again next year. So it's been very, very successful, and I know that we won't stop there. We're continuing to tell different stories through different brands, and the beauty of it is that the brands really want to be there with us. They're funding these efforts. Pampers, Vicks, all of the brands that we know and love, they really understand and know that we want to be fully represented in the way that we're advertising and telling stories through ads. So I think it's been really powerful, and I'm really proud of the work that we're doing in that space.
Congresswoman Plaskett, this year, Congress welcomed a record number of women to both the House of Representatives and the Senate. Of voting and non-voting members is 153 women out of 540. So this is a big, big achievement. What do you think are the benefits of seeing more women in Congress and across other industries?
Thank you for that. And, you know, I just wanted to point out, you talked about The Talk. And if many of you may have seen President Biden in his State of the Union address, you know, several days before he did the State of the Union, the executive members of the Congressional Black Caucus went and met with him. You know, it was right after a police killing of a Black man. And we talked with him about The Talk. and to hear the President of the United States discuss the talk to the members of Congress and to the American people, to me, was just a profound experience. You know, I have four black sons. I have a black husband. We know what that talk is. And to see that on Procter & Gamble's screen and then from the president is really, I think, a tremendous step for us as a nation. But there's so much work to be done. And that's the same with women in Congress as well. You know, we have so many numbers. We are not monolithic. As you say, we range in our experiences as well as our political philosophy. If we were more similar, maybe there would be an Equal Pay Act that was passed, right? So let's not be fooled that all women are thinking the same way. But I think that having so many women in Congress, statistically, it's shown that women are more willing to work across the aisle. They're more willing to engage with other people and to make compromise and to negotiate and to sit and to, you know, as a lawyer, I know that the best deal is when everybody feels a little angst, right? Everybody is not entirely happy. Everybody gets a little bit of what they want. And women are naturally inclined to do that. And so more work gets done in Congress when there are more women there who have a range of experiences and a range of thoughts. But we have a far way to go. 2 years ago, when I was, Nancy Pelosi named me as an impeachment manager in the second impeachment of former President Trump, I was the only black woman in the Senate chamber when I was speaking, the only black person, which caused me at one point to have to address what I felt was black stereotyping that was done on the other side. That's not what I wanted to be discussing, but I had to stop what I was doing and have that conversation on national television, because what would be the point of me being there if I let that go? And so I think having more women involved in the political process from, listen, not just as members of Congress, but on school boards, and city councils, at state legislatures, brings the issues that are important to everyday Americans and that negotiation and that ability to come and compromise for the good of the community is done. In the same way that Procter & Gamble realizes that money given to women businesses, women advertisers, goes much further, unfortunately, I'm sorry, men, than it does with men. Right? And so that's an investment, I think, that we can make in our country. So when women succeed, everyone succeeds.
Patina, your role as Rock in the Starz show, Power Book 3, Raising Kanan, has really resonated with audiences. Why do you think that is? Do you think audiences are looking for this dynamic, interesting, multidimensional female character?
Absolutely. Oh my God, absolutely. I think for me, Rock is just, I feel she's universal, and that's the way I wanted to create this character. Yes, on the surface, she is a black woman, that is who she is, but there are so many things about her that you can tap into, you know, whether you look like her or not, you know, being a mother, you know, raising a son, you know, and what that's like, being ambitious, having all of these dreams, and really just so bold and apologetically herself, and standing tall in rooms where, you know, maybe she wouldn't be able to, but she does that all, and she's able to do things that make, I don't know, she's just so strong, and she's in your face, and I think that's what people can identify with her. And, you know, I will say, for me, three-dimensional characters are something that I am always chasing. I see something on the page, and I try to think about myself, think about the women in my life, think about circumstances, where I come from. I love to use, you know, my own past experiences and bring that to my work. And I've been blessed to be around some incredible women in my life. And so for me, as a storyteller, it's about finding parts of all of these women that I can connect to and putting them into her. And, you know, I think people feel that, and they love that about her. And yeah, that's why I think people love her.
Certainly a very authentic character and has a lot of dynamic sides. Nicole, How did you become interested in a career in public policy and government? Was it difficult to break into this field that is so traditionally male?
Okay, that's a good one. Well, I've been interested in politics since I was young. That's probably a story for another time. But it is very male dominated. I think that I was lucky to be exposed to what this work is, the fact that it impacts people's everyday lives. And I think one of the things I really try to do is make sure that I expose young students. I went to Hampton University. I'm an HBCU graduate, very proud to be an HBCU graduate. I try to really bring Hampton students to Washington, talk to other students about what these careers are like, because I think that's the first part of just knowing that it exists and knowing that it's possible. I think other people here have talked about just being able to see what's possible is so important when people are deciding what they want to be and what they want to do. And then as far as it being so male dominated and hard, I think, yes, it is. Am I the only black person, potentially only woman in a lot of rooms, sometimes the only working mom in a lot of rooms? Yes, I'm the only one in a lot of rooms. I've always been the only one in a lot of rooms. But I think what I've tried to do and what has really helped me in my career is I have amazing networks of women around me. I've also had amazing male mentors in my life that have done a lot to help guide me on my career path, but I've had amazing, amazing networks of women. My own kitchen cabinet of women, I think probably everybody up here has that in their lives, and that's how I've really made it through. I think when I was an early young lobbyist, I'd never done telecom. It was very white, male dominated. In this town, still is. Several of us from different backgrounds, different races, different ethnicities, realized that we were young and we weren't really hearing about what was going on. We weren't golfing with all the guys. We weren't really at the same bars or cigar bars or whatever. And we started getting lunch together and sharing information. And that's how, you know, we started all kind of, I still hang out with all of these ladies to this day. We're all in different places in our career, but really those networks is what got me through those times. So I'm really blessed to have that.
Patina, you have an impressive career on film, television, Broadway. Can you talk to people about what it was like to overcome the obstacles that get you to that place? I mean, what kind of advice would you give to young women who want to pursue the arts?
I will say, first off, I have to say, you know, my journey to being where I am right now, we would be here all night, but to dream and to really just be, I don't know, if it's something that you want, you just have to fight for it, you know. And for me in my career, I grew up in South Carolina. My mom had me at 15, you know. I wasn't supposed to be doing what I'm supposed to be doing now, but through her fight, her struggle, pushing me to always believe in myself and to dream, you know, even when it seemed impossible, I've always had that passion and that drive from a very young girl. So I was the one where you weren't going to tell me no. And if you told me no, I would take it. I'd feel sorry for a little bit, but I would get right back up, work my butt off to prove you wrong. And that's what I've done over and over again, is I've always tried to work as hard as I can to be better. And I'm always, even right now, the bar, I'm always not reaching perfection, but it's how can I be better? How can I be better? Who can I learn from? And it's, you know, you can't stop learning. You have to always try to find and reach out to people who have something to offer you. And it's a hard business, but my biggest piece of advice is trusting your gut, trusting your instincts, and knowing that you're right where you're supposed to be, but it does not come without work.
Well said. Madalene, like you, the women on this panel representing government, corporate, entertainment are continuing to pave the way and empower a new generation of female leaders. Why is it so important for women to support other women?
Well, I think it's quite evident from this panel, from all of the speakers here, that each of us, you know, have other women who support us, uplift us, serve as cheerleaders for us. I was just reminded of a photo that was taken in 1991, and it was on the New York Times, and it was a picture of former Congresswoman Patsy Mink, along with Eleanor Holmes Norton, Pat Schroeder, and that picture was really, they were crossing to the Capitol, to the Senate side, and what they were going to was actually the Anita Hill hearing, and they wanted to be there to support her. And I think those are sort of the examples of what I would like to be for my colleagues from all sorts of communities as we work together to find our way to equity. And I think the women supporting women, as the Congresswoman has noted, you know, not everyone comes from the same political ideology. And that spectrum really does range. And at the same time, you can still find common threads that will create public policy that will help people. So I think this idea that women supporting women is helpful for the sheer fact that we are half of this country. We really do need to create our own networks because we've seen what the networks have done in support of men and their elevation into leadership roles. And for us as women, I believe, you know, in my work, I have a program at APACS that's called the Women's Collective. Next week, we're having a Her Story event because we recognize that we need to show younger generations that there are women who have overcome obstacles and challenges to achieve the goals that these younger women look to gain themselves. And so part of that work is also making sure that we're working with other communities of color. And so we work on a women's summit that basically brings together Latinas, Black women, Indigenous women, to really talk about the challenges that each of us face. Because when we see this level of sexism running for office and the threats that actually come to bodily harm to women to run for office, that it is so important for us to support one another in regardless of whether or not you agree with them politically. Because that argument itself does not attach itself to a public policy discussion. It attaches to sexism, racism, ageism, ableism, all the things that we believe are not attached to a true public policy discussion. So even though I might disagree with a woman's public policy view, if someone attacks her because she's a woman running for office, I'm gonna have to say something. And that's a part of making sure that we're grounded in reality to when you're having these public policy discussions. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think it's important for us to really examine that and making sure that when we are, you know, looking at other women who want to be in this field or any other industry, you know, to be sure that we're, you know, cooperating in a way that says we're here to support one another and hopefully we all succeed.
Congresswoman Plaskett, you've gone from growing up in Brooklyn and St. Croix to now representing thousands in Congress. You serve as the ranking member of the Subcommittee on the National Intelligence Enterprise Committee. You're a ranking member of the Select Subcommittee on the Weaponization of the Federal Government. And during the 117th Congress, Vogue named you the breakout star of the Senate impeachment trial. How do you feel about where you stand today? And what do you think about the image you're projecting for young women across the country?
I think about that a lot. And when, you know, you were talking, Nicole, about being the only in a room, you know, that's been my life. I grew up in the projects in Brooklyn, but I went to a Quaker school in downtown Brooklyn. I went to a boarding school, a prep school in New England, where out of, you know, 900 students, it was like maybe 11 of us that were Black. So I've always been very conscious of being representative of my race, of my community, of my family. You know, how many of us were like, don't go out there and embarrass me? You know, you carrying my name, you better not mess up my good name, my good name that I put out there. And I take that, that's really internalized with me. And as a Virgin Islander, you know, I represent a very small place. And so me being able to have a national audience, I know is a point of pride, not just to the people at home, but to the Caribbean region, to the people in Brooklyn, to African American people and to women. You know, my community is so small, I go grocery shopping and little girls will be like, are you Stacey Plaskett? You know, that's important to me that I'm always doing what's necessary to take time and ask them, how are you doing in school? Are you listening to your mother? You look so beautiful. You're so pretty. Can I hug you? To let them know that they are loved, that they are cared for in the community that is raising them up. And the one thing that I always try to instill with them, and I think, I hope my staff, my team sees it well, is discipline and self-sacrifice. That's something that has been a motto of mine, and I think is the thing that has, without the sacrifice, I wouldn't be where I am, the sacrifice of my family, my community, to sacrifice to put me where I am, and that I then, paying that forward, also have to sacrifice sometimes self, be disciplined about what I am doing to ensure that, you know, when someone tells me no, that I have the fortitude to go through. And, you know, I see so many other members of Congress who are that way, and cabinet members like, you know, Deb Holland, to see a Native American woman running an agency is just, how profound is that, that she is over Indian Affairs, you know? Or Marsha Fudge, my good friend, as Secretary of HUD, in being concerned with housing, and you know, Secretary Tai over trade, and the trade representative whose family, you know, immigrated here from Taiwan to be making the negotiating for trade. I think those are stories that little girls need to know. The little boys need to know that there is equality among the women that they are going to be dealing with and going to school with. And I'm hopeful that my life reflects that.
Patina, the entertainment industry has made progress in the last few years as it relates to representation. And we know that Starz is very focused on, and they want to make sure it's not just in front of the camera, but behind the camera. How do you feel when you walk onto a set and you see a female director or female crew members? Is that something that you're used to seeing?
It is not. I love that we've all talked about being one of the only in a lot of circumstances. And for me, in my career, I went to a performing arts boarding school. I was one of two. You know, I was on Broadway and always looking one of two in those and looking out into the audience where no faces, there weren't any faces that looked like mine. You know, so being on a show where none of the writers look like you, you know, but they're writing for you. So it can kind of make you feel some type of way. It makes you feel like you're I'm being nice. I had those experiences. They weren't the best experience that I've ever had. But through that, I found that I said I never wanted to be a part of any project where my voice didn't matter. And, you know, being able to be in the Starz family now, I feel so empowered and so uplifted. You know, it allows me to go to work and do what I love to do and create, knowing that I have the support of those around me. And walking onto a set to see someone who looks like me, it's the first time I've ever acted with other Black people. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. In a show. I mean, that's big for me. You know, it's the first time I've ever been on a show with you know, a Black show, I'll just say it. So, you know, you come to work and you're able to just be without trying to explain anything, without trying to, you know, oh, hope I don't offend, or, you know, all of the things that I have had to sort of arm myself to get through certain situations. So to be able to see women come in, Black women, Spanish women, and we've had so many different types of women come in as directors, our script supervisors, you know, it makes you it just feels really great. Makes you feel like, yeah. When it's like this, when it can just be that diverse, it just allows us to do the best work. And, you know, we are doing really great work. And that is because it is the representation in front of and behind the camera is wonderful. And so I thank Starz.
Madalene, in the last few years, there have been a lot of AAPI breakout films that have been huge box office successes. They've won Oscars, international awards. It's clearly resonating their stories with a diverse audience. Can you talk a little bit about the role of advocacy efforts and other groups in the industry and in politics who have made this happen?
So I think this year is the 30th anniversary of the Joy Luck Club. Which, yes, we, you know, so when we, when they came out, I think APAX was only not yet a year into its inception. And so when we had our 25th anniversary, I honored the Joy Luck Club cast because I felt it was really important to really recognize that that was really the first for my community as a mainstream movie. And then we've seen Crazy Rich Asians, we've seen, you know, Fresh Off the Boat, we've seen a lot more, you know, TV series, shows, movies, things of that nature. And along the way, we also recognized, you know, we needed to also take direction of our own narrative. So we have the Center for Asian American Media, which started in the 80s, CAPE, the Coalition of Asian Pacifics and Entertainment in the 90s, most recently Gold House. These organizations have been tirelessly working to really bring together the executives who greenlight these stories, to bring the creatives and the talent to be able to nurture that and to find, again, the ladder that says we're going to help you in that career trajectory. So I think a lot of that has been helpful in terms of making sure that we focus on the narratives of this community, which again is not a monolith. So you have so much diversity within the Asian American space and then the Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders. And so I think this is a part of the work that these organizations have done tirelessly when you think about how they have the centers and houses over at Sundance. They have a lot of these types of gatherings and convenings so that you can learn about the creatives and the business side. So I think those types of interactions have really been helpful in seeing our stories out in more mainstream America.
Nicole, the importance of allyship and the power of coalitions is a critical part of the LEAD resolution. In your career, how have you seen allyships make impact in moving the needle to bring forth systematic change? And why is it important to continue pushing initiatives like LEAD?
Yeah, I was so, when I first heard about the LEAD resolution in the last Congress, I was blown away by the leadership of Starz in this space and really starting off with acknowledging the need for diversity in media and entertainment and what it means and the outcomes that, you know, I wanted to be a part of it. I wanted to understand what they were doing. The Congresswoman talked about forming a caucus with like-minded members of Congress. And, you know, on the other side, you know, on the off-the-hill side of policy, a lot of times we're mimicking that caucus feel in order to influence policy. And that's really what coalition building is. I don't know that there's not many legislative wins that I've had in my career that have not been through a coalition, creating a coalition. And so I'm really excited to see where the LEAD resolution goes now that it's reintroduced and how we can be a part of it and how hopefully other media partners, other advertisers can be a part of it as well. Really excited about the future of that.
Congresswoman Plaskett, like many industries, entertainment has a diversity and equity problem. Starz is working on legislation with some of your colleagues on both sides of the aisle to address this. How is it important from the government side to work with Starz and other companies on DEIA initiatives?
You know, I see that there is in some states right now, blowback, right, against DEIA, like that's a dirty word. We heard the second gentleman saying that that's not a dirty word. And I think it's important for us to give them those that want to be engaged in it, the tools to be able to show how successful it is for their business. I mean, DEIA is profitable. It helps the bottom line. When you have the diversity within your core units, they're able to identify issues and problems in larger groups. So giving them the statistics to show that. And then also, you know, acting as a carrot and a stick to those companies, particularly using the carrot to try and get companies to, whether it's tax incentives or tax credits or others, to try and expand the base that they're doing. And I think that you see members of Congress, you know, I sat on the Ways and Means Committee, and we had a whole task force on this issue because we recognize that this is profitable and it's in the best interests of our country. That not investing in minority communities, not investing in advancing this, has really detrimental effects to us as a society. And so I think that it's Congress's responsibility to use the federal government to try and ensure that companies are equipped with the tools and the information to be able to make these decisions to their shareholders, as well as to their consumers and those that their customers, to be able to advance this for their own good.
So I want to ask all of you this as a closing question before we take some questions from the virtual audience and the live audience. But what does the trajectory look like to actually reaching, you know, systematic change in diversity and inclusion in each of your industries, or, you know, the entertainment industry as well? Just sort of curious to see what it looks like. You want to start, Nicole?
I mean, I think P&G has tried to give a call to action to our competitors and others. I think there are actually a lot more diversity that we're seeing all over the media, including in advertising. And I'd like to say we help pave the way for that. But I think what that looks like is that as you're moving through life, you see yourself, you see your full self, you see the joy, you see all of your life played out. And I think that will ultimately, as the Congresswoman said, that's good for business, that's good for people, and that's good for our friends who don't know enough about how other people live and what their lives are like. So ultimately, I'd just like to see more of that. That's the representation part. And I'm hoping that we're going in that direction and that we don't have too many barriers to that moving forward.
You know, right now, the Asian American community is experiencing tremendous amounts of anti-Asian hate. The aspect of this has been really a spotlight on the invisibility of the Asian American community. I think a lot of times when we do work, we survey voters and we ask them, you know, their feelings about Asian American women candidates, especially those who are running for executive office, such as governor. And a lot of times they put us in the same category as white women because they don't see us as a community of color. And so that information only just helps me to inform candidates so that they have a better recognition of how they explain themselves and their narrative to voters. At the same time, I also want to take that information and share with them the privilege that we have to, say, use this platform to protect the women who are Latinas and Black who don't have that same sort of level of respect. And I say this is important because the DEI aspect of work means being authentic. And we want our Asian American women to be proud of who they are and to not feel that they have to assimilate or be anything other than themselves. And it's the same thing when we say this to our Latina and Black colleagues, our Indigenous colleagues, because that in itself is the empowerment of our individual communities, that our worth and value is based in our history, and that we shouldn't erase that history to have a deeper and richer understanding of each other, and where we see our communities as we begin to elect more women into office?
I'll say that, you know, the business of politics is about power. And I note that both sides of the aisle recognize that having more candidates of color really helps them in terms of gaining majority, right? And in many of the areas that the Republicans were able to take Democratic seats, it was with candidates of color. And you're seeing an increase as well among Democrats in areas that are Black people are and people of color, Latinas, others are representing communities that are not majority minority. That's very evident. But the issue that we continue to have is who's at the head of the table. Particularly for women of color, we are not seeing them getting leadership roles in the Congress. While white women may, and men of color, it's very rare to have caucuses elect women of color into leadership roles. And a lot of that, at the end of the day, has to do with money. Who can raise the most money? Who is going to give the most money? Corporations, PACs, individuals are not giving money to Black women. They're not giving money to Latina women who are doing and casting the same votes, doing the same work, most of the time doing more work than the men are, but they don't receive that money, which is where the power is. And so I think that's the last hurdle for us as women, and particularly women of color, in elected office in this country. And that's the hurdle for women getting the executive seat. You know, we have white women who are governors, but we don't have any Black women or any Latina women who are, well, we have Michelle Lujan Grisham, who is absolutely fantastic, but there are very few women who are in those positions, and I think a lot of that has to do with power, which is controlled by money.
I mean, mic drop, everyone. I don't know what else I have to add. No, I think that Starz has done a wonderful job of leading the charge in that respect. So I think having these types of conversations where we can all come together and really talk about all of these things, I think that's how we truly, you know, affect change. That's how we do it. And, you know, hopefully it won't just be Starz. Hopefully other corporations and networks will jump on, you know, the bandwagon, and it doesn't have to be such a huge topic, that it just is what it is, you know? So yeah, that's all I have to say.
Do we have any questions from our audience, the in-person audience?
It's okay if I don't.
I think we can get you one. There you go.
Hi, my name, hello. Hi, I'm Rayana Malone. My question is that, I think, Rep. Plaskett, you mentioned this earlier, but when we look at state legislatures and even the House of Representatives, where the majority is controlled by those that might not look like the minority in the communities that we represent, I'm wondering, what does success look like? So for example, in Florida, there's the Don't Say Gay bill that alienates a lot of communities, that's Black and LGBTQA communities. So what does success look like when we feel as if we're not moving forward?
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned Florida. I was there just this past weekend. talking to and trying to mobilize people to come out. You know, there's a level of fear in this country, a level of feeling left behind in this country that, you know, a group of Americans are using and harnessing that fear and that feeling left behind for purposes that are not really inclusive of all of us, that are trying to divide us as a nation. Not recognizing that by all of us lifting each other up, that we as a country and individually will advance. So I think what success looks like is those communities not letting their voice be stifled, not being, Madeline, as you said, being invisible, not allowing themselves to be visible. And I think it's the job of those of us who are in office, even those of us who are in the entertainment industry, to let them know that they're seen, right? When you represent a single Black woman in an inner city and showing that she has power, that gives some sometimes those silent, those people who feel silenced, the ability to believe that they can do it. And I think each one of us plays a role in doing that.
Hold on one second.
Okay, that's okay. Thank you. Patina, this question is for you. I have a question about not only representations of women and women of color, but really at the intersection of race, gender, and age. Because I think about somebody like Cheryl Lee Ralph, who has been outstanding and fierce and talented for years. Right, right. And some of us knew it, but now the rest of the world now gets a chance to see it. But she should have been at a better place a long time ago in her career. And I think about, even though this film about Tom Brady with Lily Tomlin and all them. So it seems like representations of older women are more abundant with white women, but we see some change with like Cheryl Lee Ralph and even a film like Girls Trip about women in their 40s, which was a big smash hit. So where do you see representations of women of color older than 40 going in Hollywood, and where should they go?
I mean, I don't think it should have taken as long as it have. I mean, when you think about Viola Davis, you know, she's been incredible for the longest time, but Fences, you know, that put her on the map in that way, but she's been doing fantastic work for forever. There are a lot of women of color who have been doing this for a long time and only just now getting the recognition. I think as the conversation moves forward, as there is more of an amplification of what it is, and I think people are talking about it now, you know, they're finally being able to, there's finally stories where they can sort of put themselves into it, and it's not, I don't know. It's a hard question because we're still finding it. And I think that, like, through Cheryl Lee Ralph winning, you know, being celebrated how she is now, and Viola Davis and Angela Bassett and all of these, I think the conversation is moving in that, you know, we're still out here and we can still do it and we can still create and we should still be celebrated. And I hope that it continues. You know, I hope that we will continue to write for women of that age, and that they get to, you know, they get to be three-dimensional as well, right? Because it looks very different than, you know, a woman in their 30s or 20s, but there is still something to celebrate and that it's not forgotten. So I hope that it continues to change.
Thank you. This was a fabulous discussion, and I want to thank everyone for participating in the audience and for your amazing contributions to the conversation.